Hey guys, welcome to Best Movie Recap. Today we have a crime comedy movie from 2004 called Ocean's 12. It is the second installment of the Ocean's franchise. For a better understanding of the movie, I invite you to watch the first chapter, which is available in the link below the description. Without any further delay, let's get started. The movie begins few years after the Benedict job, where the crew manages to steal $160 million. Rusty Ryan, who is now living in Rome, visits a woman with whom he is romantically involved. The woman is a detective, and after she tells him of her investigative work that day, he becomes anxious that she might link him with a particular crime, so he secretly escapes from the apartment. The scene shifts 3.5 years later. Danny and Tess have moved into a new home, where they plan to start a new life. Without any warning, Terry Benedict arrives at their house while Danny is out. Having discovered that Danny and the crew were responsible for robbing him, Benedict confronts Tess and tells her that he's giving the team 2 weeks to come up with the $160 million plus $38 million interest. After he leaves, he again visits each and every member of the crew and gives them the same warning. In order to discuss their dilemma, the crew privately meets in an old factory. After a few calculations, the team realizes they are short $97 million, which they must get in 14 days or they are dead men. Everyone is on board for paying back Benedict, except Saul, who doesn't intend to continue practicing cons. Without Saul, Danny Ocean and the team decide to stage another heist to pay off the debt. Being too hot to work in America, they pick a European target. There, Danny and Rusty connect with Matsui at a coffee shop. Looking to come into a role more leadership, Linus also attends the meeting with Matsui. After an exchange of pleasantries, Danny, Rusty, and Matsui use language which Linus doesn't comprehend to mess with him. Matsui then commissions the crew for the Van Der Wow job, of which the objective is to steal the world's oldest stock certificate, which was issued by the Dutch East India Company in 1602, worth around 2.5 million euros, and is kept in Amsterdam. The team hopes that the certificate value is payment enough to extend their deadline until they can find a bigger score. As they reach the safe supposedly containing the document, they find its only contents are a small fox figurine with an audio player. They play it and the voice on the recording addresses Danny, explaining how it got to the safe first, stole the document, and set up the crew to fail their commission before they had even begun to plan for it. They infer that the person behind the voice is the same man who revealed their information to Benedict. Later on that day, an investigation begins in response to the stolen document. Assigned to the case is Detective Isabel Lahiri, the same woman with whom Rusty had been previously involved. The investigation was such a priority that she was interrupted at an Interpol convention during her presentation on the Night Fox, an especially prominent thief. She arrives at the crime scene and begins working her way around looking for clues. She eventually figures out that both Rusty and the Night Fox broke into the estate on the same night, and that the Night Fox stole the document before the crew could. Having the lead on Rusty gave her the opportunity to arrest Frank, whom she had already known to be an accomplice in a job Rusty pulled while they were in Rome. After catching and arresting Frank, she traces Rusty to the hotel where the crew is staying. An unsuspecting Rusty answers her knock at their hotel room door. Isabel catches a glimpse of Danny and Yen just before Rusty slams the door in her face. After quietly ushering the rest of the crew into another room to hide, he lets her in. He doesn't say much as she remarks about his various activities there in Amsterdam. She brings up the Night Fox and indicates him as the person who left the figurine and the audio recording for Danny during the night of the heist. She subsequently advises Rusty to submit to the Night Fox, then makes her way to the exit, mentioning Frank's arrest as she does. After she leaves, the crew rebukes Rusty for having put them at such a risk, which ultimately caused Danny and Yen's pictures to be used in her case. However, the three of them escape her surveillance by impersonating members and equipment of the Arsenal Football Club. Then they all went to a train station to reunite, but the bag where Yen was hiding is sent to another place in Europe. After that, they meet elsewhere and Danny elaborates on who the Night Fox is. They find out that the Night Fox's real name is Francois Towler, a notorious European thief who was trained by the legendary retired thief Gaspar Lemmerk and believes himself to be the world's greatest thief. The crew decides to get him back for hindering them during the first mission. They steal several of his paintings from his home in Italy. Then Danny meets him face to face. It turns out that the fox is the one who revealed the identities of the 11 to Benedict. He is incensed that his mentor Lemmerk agreed to call Danny the best thief in the world after hearing of the elaborate complexities of the Bellagio job from a friend. So in order to lure the team to Europe, the fox broke rule number one, which is revealing another thief's identity. He then proposes a challenge to Danny, since going after the same object is the only way to tell who the best thief is. Within a week, both Danny's group and the Night Fox will attempt to steal the famous coronation egg in Rome, Italy. And the first to succeed will be declared the best thief. Also, if Danny's team wins, the fox will pay off the team's debt to Benedict in its entirety. With no other options and time running out, Danny accepts the challenge. Meanwhile, Frank sits in jail, and Saul contemplates his decision to not help the crew pay back Benedict. With Rusty's stolen phone, Agent Lahiri obtains information from Roman Nagel, a cohort of the crew who attempted to reach Rusty in order to relay a message about his progress. Isabel surmises that the crew is about to steal something, and she pleads with her superior Commissario Giordano to use the Form 1077, an official request for additional resources in her investigation, but he refuses her offer. Having observed the workings of the museum, where the egg will be held, Livingston and Rusty go over a few plans for stealing it. They choose one and the entire crew reviewed this rather complicated plan. Nagel eventually meets with the crew, presenting to them a hologram device he built to display the image of the Fabergé coronation egg. After having been thoroughly impressed with the device, their confidence drops down as it's revealed to them that Agent Lahiri had Rusty's phone for at least 2 days. Returning from the visit with Giordano, Lahiri arrives at her apartment, where Rusty was waiting for her. Mistaking him for an intruding stranger, she nearly shoots him. After recognizing who he was, the two begin to casually chat about his phone, their past, and the crew's involvement with the Night Fox. She also explains her intention to see her investigation through. She then ushers him to the exit and threatens to arrest him at their next meeting. Once alone, she prepares a copy of an old discarded signed Form 1077 and a fresh form. Then she forges Giordano's signature from the old form onto the new one. Afterward, Lahiri meets with Towler, who is in disguise as André Simon, talking about his stolen paintings. After he gives her security footage of the theft, she heads back home and uses the submitted forged Form 1077 to acquire the additional resources she needs for her case, while issuing a bulletin for the apprehension of several members of the crew. The next morning, with only 2 days remaining in Benedict's ultimatum, Lahiri guards the egg at its exhibit in a Roman museum. While the Night Fox is doing his daily exercises, the crew set themselves according to their plan. Even though the Roman authorities are stationed outside the museum at the checkpoint to verify the identity of all incoming patrons, they attempt to follow through with the plan anyhow. Before they know it, the members who have been identified by Lahiri are being rounded up. Only Basher, Turk, and Linus escape the arrest. The three meet back at the warehouse they'd been using to set up their plan, unaware that Towler has had the place under his own camera surveillance. They go over alternate plans that might work, but they need more members, so Linus suggests a plan involving Tess. Turk and Basher initially disapprove, but Linus persuades them and eventually calls Tess without telling her anything. When Tess arrives in Rome, Linus, Basher, and Turk explain her role. She is portrayed as pregnant Julie Roberts. With her role set, they arrive at the hotel, where they ran into Bruce Willis, who is in Rome on vacation, and with this added complication, they are joined by Saul posing as Tess's doctor. Their second attempt almost works, but ends with the capture of the rest of the team, partially due to the unintended interference from Bruce Willis. With the whole team now captured, a US official named Molly Starr arrives to interrogate and officially arrests the team on behalf of the US government for the Bellagio job. She starts off by dismissing Lahiri for irregularities in her paperwork. She then calls Linus into the interrogation room because he looks about to break and does so quite easily. Linus confesses his crimes and the whole team gets officially arrested. The team is then transported to the airport for extradition. On their way to the airport, Molly gives Linus the key to his handcuffs, revealing herself as his mother, who was part of the plan all along. Rusty's car changes lanes and takes him to a private jet, followed by Isabel. Rusty then reveals to Isabel that her long-lost father, whom she thought had died a long time ago, is actually alive, but was prevented from seeing his daughter ever again by her mother, who had threatened to go to the police with everything she knows about him if he ever tried to contact Isabel. Rusty then convinces her to get on the plane with him so he can take her to her father. Meanwhile, Frank is released from the prison with the help of Danny's friends, who pretend to be a lawyer. Later on that night, Danny and Tess meet the Night Fox at his house. He arrogantly savors his victory and delights in explaining how he was able to steal the egg by climbing to the roof of the museum at night without being detected by Danny's recon team. Then he passed through the laser grid by breakdancing his way to avoid triggering the alarm, having trained his body to quickly adopt odd positions. Danny admits to the Night Fox that he is indeed the best thief, but then demands him to pay what he owes him with a smirk. The Night Fox gets confused at first, but then he realizes that it was never about a thief contest between Danny and him. It was an elaborate long con, and he fell for it. It is then revealed that the contest was over before it ever began, and the egg that the fox stole was a fake. When they got to Amsterdam, Danny and Rusty had a secret meeting with Lemmerk, who warned them about the Night Fox's plans and gave them the location of the real egg, which was transported in a plain backpack instead of the armored car. Lemmerk also warned Danny and Rusty to assume that the Night Fox would always have them under surveillance, and they will have to put on an elaborate show for him. The team then followed the backpack and its security detail on a train, where they got in a pretend fight with each other to distract the security guards, while Linus switched the bag with an identical bag while no one was looking. The bag is then seen at their hideout and on the plane with Rusty and Isabel. Hearing this, the fox is crestfallen, and Danny leaves victorious. Meanwhile, Rusty takes Isabel to a beachside villa, where he reveals to her that her father wasn't just any thief, but the world-famous Gaspar Lemmerk. Lemmerk then reveals that he had been waiting for Isabel's mother to pass away to finally reveal himself to his daughter. Rusty drops the bag containing the coronation egg as a gift to Lemmerk and leaves the father and daughter together. After that, Reuben meets up with Benedict to pay him honestly and in full. During their conversation, the Night Fox can be seen in the background disguised as one of Terry Benedict's gardeners, implying that the Night Fox plans to rob Terry Benedict in order to prove himself once again and to get his money back. Thanks for watching. If you like the video, put a like and share it. Also, don't forget to subscribe for more. Have a great day.